Hey everyone, we are 3 weeks away from the end of the school year. And can I just say that you are amazing for still being here and listening to this and watching this? Like, I understand this has been a really crazy couple months. And I'm just so impressed at how many of you are still staying on board with everything and watching these videos and keeping up with the material. So I just like my hat is off to you. You're awesome. This is a weird hard time and you are doing great. So all that being said, I know that this final 3 weeks, it's going to be a little bit of a crunch. You've got AP exams and other things going on. And I have heard you. I know that you are stressed out in general. And our last unit that we're about to start on is astronomy. And I just want us to enjoy learning a little bit about the universe and like how crazy and amazing it all is. So I'm going to try to scale back a little bit further during this unit then. So I'm not going to be assigning notes or practice or just watch the video on Edpuzzle and interact with it a little bit so I know that you're actually like thinking and not just like zoning out in front of the computer. And let's just enjoy and take it easy and not worry about anything, okay? So let's go for it. Let's go ahead and start talking a little bit about astronomy at this point. All right. You've asked a number of really great questions. I figure we'll start with the basics on stars and how they work and what they do for the next couple days, and then we'll try to get into some of those more advanced or niche questions that you have as we round out the end of the semester. So for today, we're just going to be focusing in general, like what do stars do over the course of their lifetime? How do they change from the time they are created to the time they die, because stars die. And related to that, we're also going to get into a little bit of how we start to measure things about stars when they are so far away and we can't just like show up and collect data. So we'll talk a little bit about star temperature as we are looking at the evolution of stars over time. So first of all, just some basic facts on stars that most of you probably already know, but I just want to like make sure we're all on the same page here. So when we look up in the sky, we can see stars, we can see planets. Both are these celestial bodies, but they have some significant differences between them, even if they're not always easy to tell from our perspective here on Earth. Okay. So first, big difference is that stars produce their own light. Planets do not produce light. The way that we're able to see planets is because light from a star is reflecting off the planet, and then we're able to see it that way. So that's sort of one really big important difference between the two of them. Typically, stars are going to be like a lot bigger than planets as well, because they're doing this whole light manufacturing, nuclear fusion, crazy process here. So stars are bigger. But they don't look bigger from our perspective, and that's because they're way, way farther away from Earth than the planets in our solar system that we are sometimes able to see. Okay, so just to give you a little bit of data to kind of wrap your head around that. So I've got some information about a couple planets in our solar system and some information about the two closest stars to us. All right, so we've got Jupiter and Neptune representing our planets, the Sun, and then Proxima Centauri representing the stars. So if we look at the size of them, the largest planet in our solar system is about 140,000 kilometers, whereas the Sun is 10 times bigger than that. Okay, and the Sun is just sort of like an average, it's not even especially big, it's just sort of like your run-of-the-mill typical star. Proxima Centauri is a relatively small star, but it's still significantly larger than Jupiter is. Okay, so stars typically bigger than planets, and then in terms of how far away they are, all of the planets in our solar system are on the order of some number of light minutes or light hours away from us, which basically means that anything that we're able to see of Neptune, for example, being the farthest planet away, the light that we see bounced off of Neptune about 4 hours before we're able to see it. which means that anytime we're looking at Neptune, we're looking about 4 hours in the past, which is kind of cool. All right. But then for the stars, obviously the sun is close to us, which is good because, you know, we'd die without it. But Proxima Centauri is the next closest star. It's 4.2 light years away from us. Okay. So anytime we see light from Proxima Centauri, we are looking 4 years in the past as opposed to 4 hours in the past for Neptune. And certainly other stars, we're looking even farther into the past. It takes even longer for the light that they're producing to reach us. Okay. So just to give you a sense of scale on the differences there between planets and stars. All right. So stars, hey, here's some. They're so pretty. Look at them. All right. Stars, as much as I'm making these generalizations about like they're big and they're far away and stuff, there's a lot of variation within this gigantic, huge range of stars that we have. So they can vary in color, temperature, size. You can read that whole thing, right? So we see these big differences among stars. And I do want over the next couple lessons for us to just kind of dive in a little bit into some of these differences and why they exist and what's going on there. Okay. So, let's start off by kind of looking at temperature. So different stars are different temperatures, and, we can't really go to the star like with a thermometer to see how hot it is. And so the way that we're able to actually figure out the temperature of these crazy hot stars, it's actually based on, the color that we see from the light that they produce, okay? So to help us wrap our heads around this, I'm linking a simulation in the Edpuzzle video for you that I recommend that you just open up and play with a little bit. So the simulation shows us then all the different types of electromagnetic radiation that are being produced by a star at a particular temperature. Okay, so we can see on the left side here, we're getting above the visible range, sort of in like that UV range. We see our visible spectrum right here at about 500 nanometers, give or take a few hundred. And then anything to the right of that, we're now getting into like infrared and other lower frequencies for our radiation. So I want you to just play with that for a minute. Use the slider over here on the right to play with the temperature of the star and just see what happens to that curve. Look for where is the peak of that curve, because that's going to tell us what the most radiation is and therefore like what color we're going to see. We can also look in the lower right here, and see what the color of the star overall is as well. All right. So take a moment to play with that. And then tell me what color, as you play with that, what color are the hottest stars? All right. So our hottest stars, as we raise the temperature, I'm going to jump over here. All right. As we raise the temperature of our star, we see the peak of that radiation curve moving over to the left, over to the lower wavelength, higher frequency side. So as we raise the temperature up, 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 I know you can't see the peak anymore, but if you look at the star down here in the lower right, you can see that as we get to the highest temperatures, our stars look blue. Okay. So if we have a super hot star, it's going to look blue to us. And that's our indication as to what its temperature is, depending on what exactly the wavelength of that light that's being produced is and what the range is there. We can then model and make predictions about what the temperature is. And so then the coldest stars, on the other hand, so if we lower that temperature back down, 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 we get less radiation, and the peak moves over to the right more and more and more until eventually now the greatest amount of visible light is in the red range. So then we end up seeing our stars as being red if they're relatively cold. So we get the spectrum from red to the next hottest is, or the next coolest, I should say. So red is the coolest, then yellow stars, then white stars. We don't actually see green stars. That would be awesome. But the fact is, if you're green, you're sort of in the middle of the road. You're getting a lot of all the different colors. And if you have all the different colors of light, it appears white to us. Okay. So we go from red to yellow to white to blue being the hottest stars. So that's cute and a good way to figure out temperature without a thermometer and drastic space travel and you know, and all of that. Okay, cool. So then as we go through and measure data from our different stars, we look at how bright they are, we measure their temperature based on the color, we're able to start plotting out these different stars and start seeing some trends in terms of where our stars kind of land in this brightness to temperature relationship. And if we create that plot, what we're creating is something called a Hertzsprung-Russell or HR diagram. Okay. And so you can see that right here. Here's sort of our general types of stars that we see out there in the universe. Okay. So looking at, just to wrap our heads around what we're seeing here, up on the vertical axis, that's telling us the luminosity, the brightness of these stars. And it's on a logarithmic scale, which means that, that as we move down, it's not like a common increment brighter, it's getting 10 times brighter with each tick mark up that you go. So the very brightest stars are like billions of times brighter than the dimmest stars. Okay, so that's what's happening vertically. On our horizontal scale, we have temperature. Please note that it's a little bit weird because it's backwards. So higher temperature is on the left side, lower temperature is on the right side. I know it's weird. It's because we did spectral classifications first and then figured out temperature from it. But for now, it's just like, it's reversed. Go with it. Okay. So from this, then we're able to see four different like big categories of stars. We've got this big diagonal line here going through the middle, which we call the main sequence. And we get a bunch of stars like on that line. And then up above and to the right of that, we get giants, which are pretty cool but brighter than main sequence stars, and then above that, supergiants, which are even brighter than those regular old giants. And then down at the bottom left side of things, we see some white dwarfs, which are pretty hot but not very bright. Okay, so let's try to put this all into perspective a little bit. So again, I'm linking a simulation on Edpuzzle for you, so you can go in and play with this a little bit and interact with it and sort of see what's going on here. But my big recommendation with the simulation is in the upper right, you see this little menu here. There's a little check mark or check box next to something that says evolution of the sun. Go ahead and click that and you'll get to see like the sun's evolution over time traced out for you. Okay, so take a look at that. Feel free to pause me while you do that. Okay. So then I want to ask you, what type of star will the sun be for most of its life? So what we should see is that if we click on evolution of the sun here, so there our sun's formed, it's good, and then it's sitting there, and sitting there, and sitting there. Hey, here's where we are now, still sitting there. All right, so the sun is just kind of hanging out then on the main sequence for a really long time, for the majority of its life. And that's good. We like it there on the main sequence. We've kind of like everything is sort of nicely calibrated right now. So we're just going to leave it there. Okay. But then after that, we see it pop up and then whoop, goes all the way around again down to a white dwarf. Okay. So what this means then is that from the main sequence, our sun is going to become a red giant. It's going to expand, cool down, get brighter, all of that. And then it's gonna turn into a white dwarf after that. Okay. All of this is billions of years away. Please do not worry that the sun is about to expand and consume us all. It's just not gonna happen very soon. Okay. Like if you are living billions of years, then yeah, maybe you're gonna worry about that, but, You're probably not. I hate to have like that mortality discussion with you right now. Like you're not gonna see the sun turn into a red giant. That's okay, and that's a good thing. All right, cool. So that's what's going on here. This brings us then to the general life cycle of a star. Now, I know that this image, it doesn't really look like a nice straightforward linear timeline, and that's because the evolution of a star really depends on how massive it is when it forms. Okay, so there are different pathways that our stars can take. So the way to read this diagram is start in the middle, actually. The star-forming nebula, an example of that would be the Eagle Nebula, okay? And then from there, there are different pathways that our stars can take, depending on if they're massive or mid-size, or if they're really small, like Proxima Centauri, but we're going to kind of, they're not very interesting. They just stay dwarfs their whole life, so we're just going to ignore those. Focus in on these other two pathways that are kind of, you know, branching up and out from that nebula. So let's dive in and look at some pretty pictures. All right, cool. So all of our stars start off, before they're even really stars, being formed from stellar nebula. Okay, so stellar nebula, that's basically just when you've got like just this big old cloud of stardust. Okay, there's all this like stuff, all these little elements just kind of hanging out there. The thing about the stars is we've got all these particles and little bits of stars, right? And all those little bits of stars have mass. And we know from our previous studies here that anything that has mass is going to exert a gravitational force on other things, this attractive force. And so we have all these little bits of stars that are all being attracted towards each other due to gravity. Okay, and so they start off really diffuse, and then over time they start to condense together to form an actual star due to gravity. Thank you, gravity. All right, so then once we get our star to actually properly form then, it sits on the main sequence for a while. So that's phase two, the first part and the longest part of a star's life is just being along the main sequence. It's fusing hydrogen. We're gonna talk more about that next time. Everything's good. It's just doing its thing, all right? So there's a large range of masses for the stars that form, okay? So our sun is sort of like a mid-size, like typical kind of star. We sort of got like, you know, your middle of the road star, so that's good, okay? But there are other stars that are like way bigger and more massive than the sun, so you can kind of see a representation of that here. Now, if you look at this, what do you notice about the difference between these, aside from the fact that the sun is very tiny and the high mass star is very big? What's another big difference between them? Oh, the high mass star is blue. And if the high mass star is blue, whereas our sun appears more yellowish, that means that the high mass star must also be a lot hotter than our sun. So again, really glad we don't have a high mass star because it would be too hot and we'd be done. Okay, so thank you, sun, for being just in the middle of the road. Okay, so this is where our stars hang out for most of their life. As they go through and really complete a lot of nuclear reactions in their core, over time they start using up their hydrogen. Again, we're gonna get into that more next time. And so the reactions start to move outward into the outer layers of our star. Starts off in the middle, where it's the hottest, and then over time the reactions sort of like move outward. This causes our star to expand, and as it expands, it tends to cool down, all right? Which is why it then turns into a red giant, because as stars cool down, they get redder, okay? So, there are a couple different like flavors here. If you've got sort of like an average size star like our sun, it will turn into just a regular red giant. If you have a more massive blue star, it's going to turn into a red supergiant over time, which is obviously bigger and brighter than a regular red giant. Okay, so we've got our red giant here, we've got our red supergiant over here, and then the paths diverge a little bit. Once we've used up that hydrogen, we've been fusing together elements and doing all these things, as we start to run out of fuel, there are sort of two options. Okay, so let's start with our sort of average stars similar to our sun. Okay, so if we have an average star, it turns into a red giant. It's using up its nuclear fuel, it's expanding, it's doing all that, and eventually we hit a point where the outward radiative pressure of the star becomes greater than gravity's force pushing it inward. And so as a result then, we end up with the outer layers of the star kind of getting pulled away from the star, and we form what's called a planetary nebula. Okay, so we've got this hot, dense core in the middle, and the outer layers just sort of like peace out, and they're moving away here. And so we can see two different pictures of the Helix Nebula, which is pretty and frequently photographed because it kind of looks like an eyeball. So that's cute. All right. So our red giant then, turns into this planetary nebula. Outer layers get pushed away. We're just left with this little hot, dense core, which then turns into a white dwarf. Okay. And so our white dwarf no longer has nuclear reactions. It can't really continue to form new elements at this point. And so it's just kind of like, it's in retirement. It's just cruising through the rest of its existence. Okay. And so at this point, still pretty hot at this point, because again, we still got that hot core remaining from the planetary nebula. But it's getting smaller because we've lost a lot of the material in that nebula. So a typical white dwarf is about the same mass as our sun, but about the same size as Earth. So it's pretty dense. Hanging out, doing its thing, continuing to let off residual light. Over time, it'll turn into a brown dwarf as it gets dimmer, and a black dwarf, and then our star's done, and it's lived its life, and that's good. And that's lasted for billions of years, so like we don't need to feel like sad for like, oh, the star died. Like it's fine. It had a good run. Okay, so that's what happens for our average stars, similar to our sun. But what about the more massive stars? So again, they are bluer. They are bigger, obviously, they're brighter, and then as their reactions move from the core out into the outer atmosphere of the, or the outer layers of our star, they become red supergiants. What happens then? All right, after the red supergiant, this is where it gets exciting. That's where we get a supernova, all right, which you've maybe heard of before, which is basically like, we've got all these reactions happening. There's so much going on in terms of the gravitation holding it together, the outward radiative pressure, that the star just sort of like whoosh, and explodes for us. And that looks cool. Look at that. Wow. All right. So our sun will not turn into a supernova. It's not big enough to do that. So it gets just a regular planetary nebula, also very pretty. But if you've got a really big star, we get this very dramatic, spectacular explosion in this supernova. All right. At which point, and this is where we get actually most of our heaviest elements. Again, we're going to talk more about that next time. I'm just so excited that I can't wait to tell you about it. Okay. So it just like blows stardust all over the place, which is really good for us because that's how we have all of our elements here on Earth. So thank you, supernovas. Thank you, other more massive stars, for your sacrifice billions of years ago. All right. But then there's a final stage here. There's still a little something left after this big explosion, one core here. And what happens with this core and what it does sort of depends on the mass of the original star. Okay. So if we have a moderately high mass star. Okay, so we're talking maybe on the order of like 8 times the mass of the sun to about 40 times the mass of the sun. What we end up with is something called a neutron star. Neutron stars are crazy. They are, they're really, really massive. Like we're talking about like on the order of like the mass of our sun, or maybe a couple times bigger or something like that, but super, super dense, down to a size of like 10 to 15 miles across. Okay, so imagine like the mass of the sun, or more likely, down to the size of like a city. Okay, that gives you a sense of what a neutron star is. It's formed of neutrons. It's generally spinning really fast after that supernova, which means that a lot of times we get these light flashes from these pulsars. It's very dramatic. Okay, now just to make sense of the picture that you see here on the left. So the neutron star is not this whole big, like, reddish, yellowish, greenish thing. It's that teeny white dot in the middle, okay? So this whole, the whole big colorful thing, that's the Crab Nebula that's formed after this supernova. But then down, like, if you look really closely, there's a little white dot in the middle. That is the neutron star at the center of that supernova. Okay, or where there was that supernova. And it's spinning around and doing its thing and super tiny and super dense and just crazy. Okay, so that's what happens for our like moderately massive stars. If you get a really, really massive star, like more than 40 times the mass of the sun, that's where we get black holes forming. Okay, so at this point, after our supernova explosion, we're left with this super massive, super dense, little core that is our remnant of our massive star here. And because it is so massive and because it is so dense, it has an insanely strong gravitational field. So strong that even light is not able to escape from it. It even sucks in all the light, which is why we call it a black hole, because the light can't escape. It can't bounce off of it or escape from it. It's just all getting sucked into that super, super strong gravitational field. So we can kind of see that in our picture here. We're able to sort of see the black hole in the middle, and then the sort of outline there and sort of these outer layers just beyond the event horizon there, the light that has not yet gotten sucked into the black hole. Please do not worry about getting sucked into a black hole anytime soon. There are some out there for sure, but they're kind of far away. It's going to take a while before they can kind of get to us. There are lots of things to worry about in this world right now. Getting like death by black hole is not one of them. Okay. Just so we're all clear on that. Okay. Cool. So let's finish up, check your understanding a little bit. So we've got two pictures of stars. We've got Rigel over on the left. On the right side, we've got the red giant Aldebaran. First question for you is, which star is hotter? How do you know? Well, Rigel is hotter, and we can tell that Rigel is hotter because it is blue. All right, so Rigel, we've measured based on that radiation to be about 12,000 Kelvin, whereas Aldebaran's about 4,000 Kelvin. Still hot, but not as hot as Rigel is. Okay, next up, same set of photos, but which of these stars is older? All right. Now, Rigel is a blue star, which means it's on the main sequence here. Aldebaran is a red giant. Now, main sequence stars turn into red giants and red supergiants over time. So it stands to reason then that Aldebaran is older, and indeed it is. Rigel, we estimate to be about 8 million years old, whereas Aldebaran is more on the order of 6 billion years old. Okay. Last question, which of these two stars is more massive? The fact that Aldebaran is a red giant, not a red supergiant, suggests that Aldebaran was created from an average mass star, whereas Rigel, being blue, is a more massive star. Okay, so we see here Rigel's on the order of 21 times the mass of our sun, whereas Aldebaran is a little bit more massive than our sun. So Rigel wins that particular battle, you know. Face off as well. That's it for now. I've talked for quite a while, so I think we're good. I will continue to share more information about stars as we move forward. Please let me know what questions you have, and I don't know if Edpuzzle notifies you of this, but I have been like commenting and responding to the questions that you've been asking. I have been loving them. They have been so good. So please feel free to ask me your questions, and I will comment back to you in Edpuzzle. That is it, folks. I love you. I adore you. You are great. Thanks for hanging with me, and I'll see you next time.